All right, hello, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to my talk, Keeping Your Data Sane with Bean Validation 2.0. I hope you enjoyed the conference so far. I certainly did. So for once, the topic we just heard in this room is very close to my heart because I work on this MapStruct project. But also let me tell you, this conference is a very familiar atmosphere, so you have a very good chance to get in touch with all those speakers because it's quite a compact venue. It's really nice. Very interactive, I guess. Just go to whatever speaker you would like and chat with him. It's really a good opportunity you have here. So what's on the agenda for the coming 15 minutes? So I will talk about bean validation, what it is, what can it do for you, and I will mostly do this part in the IDE, so I will go to Eclipse in a bit. Bless you, sir. I will go to Eclipse and show you how to use bean validation, how to address common use cases with it. And then in the second part, I will tell what's new in the upcoming revision, in Bean Validation 2.0. What are the new features and what are use cases which will benefit from Bean Validation 2.0? At the end, there will be time for questions and your feedback. So it's a specification which currently is still under development, although we are almost at the end. But still, I would like to have your feedback very much. And if you have any ideas or maybe you find some things which are wrong in the current draft, please speak up and let us know. Before I get started, some words on my person. So I work as a software engineer at Red Hat. I'm a member of the Hibernate team, and I guess most of you will know Hibernate is not only the classic object relational mapping tool, Hibernate ORM, but actually it's a family of open source projects. And there is, for instance, Hibernate OGM, which lets you use Hibernate and talk to NoSQL stores such as MongoDB. There's Hibernate Search, which integrates your JPA applications with full text search, for instance, using Elasticsearch. And I contribute to these projects. And actually, my colleague Sunny, which also is in the audience, he will be talking about all those Hibernate projects in a talk tomorrow. I work on Debezium, which is a change data capturing tool, which means you can have your data in some database and then Debezium will create an event stream with all the changes which happen in your database and emit those events into a Kafka queue. And then from these change data events, you can do all sorts of interesting things like populating another database, driving the updates of an Elasticsearch index, whatever. So that's change data capture, CDC, with Debezium. And yeah, then there's MapStruct, which we just have learned about, and some other projects. If you like, follow me on Twitter. I'm there, Gunnar Molling. And with that, I'm ready to get started. Just let me tell you, if there are any questions, just don't wait until the end. Just feel free to ask. I got some very nice bean validation stickers with me. And each good question or each question will earn you one bean validation sticker, if you like. All right, so what is bean validation about? It is an API and a meta model which allows you to put constraints to your model and then validate those constraints. And constraints are certain invariants, small checks, which you apply to your model. And it could be simple things like this property should never be null, or this numeric property, it should be in a specific range, or this string, it should satisfy a given regular expression. And you have all these kinds of checks which you can apply. There is a number of conditions or constraints predefined as part of the API, but as we will see in a bit, you also can quite easily add your own custom constraints. And then, well, you put those constraints using annotations to your model. This is the one part. And of course, you also want to validate those constraints. And there's an API which you could use for this. But actually, most of the time, the validation will be called automatically for you. And this means bean validation is integrated with other specs like JPA, the persistence API, or JSF, GWT, many other specs and technologies. And all those technologies will call bean validation at the right point in the object lifecycle. So for instance, JPA, it will apply those constraints when you are going to write your model into the database, making sure only valid data ever is persisted. And it's integrated with other specs from the Java EE environment. For instance, JAX-RS web service make use of this. It's integrated with other Java projects like Spring and many more. So this is essentially bean validation as it was in 1.0, Java EE 6 a couple of years ago. And then we did in Java EE 7, we did bean validation 1.1. And the most important feature of that was the notion of method validation. And method validation means you can put constraints now to the parameters and return values of your methods of your Java classes. And then if a method is invoked, these constraints will be automatically enforced. And this is a very nice thing because if you think how you would do this traditionally, so you have this method, and then probably in the first number of lines within the implementation, you would implement all those checks manually, and you would make sure this parameter, it must not be null, and it must be, well, a specific number, whatever. And if you were a careful person, you would then put all those checks to the Java doc again, because, of course, the caller of this API method, they should know which are the conditions they need to satisfy. And it's quite nasty to keep these two things in sync, right? And bean validation, method validation helps you with this because it just put annotations to the method parameters, and then these annotations get part of the public contract, so they will be added to the Java doc, actually. And callers of the API, they will see it. If they read the Java doc or if they hover over the definition in their IDE, they will see all those constraints which they then have to satisfy. And if you are running in a managed environment such as CDI or Spring, then upon method invocation, those constraints will be satisfied or will be validated. So that's it. And well, really the idea is constrain once, validate everywhere. So this means you just put your annotations, your constraints to your model once, and then whenever it makes sense, the validation will happen for you. And with that, I will go to Eclipse. And I have prepared a little application, and actually I will show this to you first. So this is a business application, a CRUD application essentially, which manages hikes. So we can have this list of hikes here. I could add a new hike. Let's say I'm from Hamburg and I walked all the way from Hamburg to Copenhagen. I could add sections here, I just added now. And then I have this hike here. I could remove it now, I could update it now. I could place orders. So it's your regular business application which manages hikes, right? And this is using Angular in the front end, it's not so important for us right now, but more important is it's using Java EE on the server, so it's using JAXRS web services, JPA for persistence. And one interesting thing is the data which I'm storing here, the hike data, it is stored in a MongoDB instance, which I have running here on my laptop. And this happens using this project I mentioned, Hibernate OGM, which actually lets you talk to NoSQL stores using the Hibernate and JPA APIs, which you all know so well. So you can essentially put your data into MongoDB or other NoSQL stores using the familiar APIs, and that's what I'm using here. So this demo is also on GitHub. If you're interested in this, you could check this out. Okay, so let me go to Eclipse. So unfortunately, I cannot increase the font size in the tree, but it should be apparent what's going on. So it's a classic Java enterprise application. I have my model here with hike and person and all those entities. I have repositories here which use the entity manager and then persist a hike or fetch a hike, whatever you have. So that's the data access layer, so to say. And I have this REST layer, which uses JAXRS. So I'm having all those JAXRS annotations pass and so on here. And then this uses the repository, for instance, to persist an order, right? So that's what you typically would expect. And let me now go and add some constraints, put some bean validation into place. And I have this customer object here. So that's the customer who ordered a hike. And I'm using public fields here, just for the sake of brevity. Of course, I could use getters and setters. I don't like it too much, so I just do this. And I put this constraint here at email. And you see it's part of the Java X validation package as of bean validation 2.0, so it's a new built-in constraint, which is nice. And I have prepared this test, and I will just start the validation manually for now. So let me create a customer. Actually, let me close this one here, whatever it is. So I instantiate a new customer, and I give it an invalid email address. And I just say there's no add character in it, so it's an invalid email address. And I get a validator. And I do this by going to this validation class. There is built default validator factory, and I can get the validator. I assign it. And now I validate it, or I call validate. And this takes for now just my customer object. And I get back a set of constraint violations. And this set will be empty in case the validation has succeeded, so no constraints are violated, then this set will be empty. If something is invalid, the set of constraint violations will tell me what has happened. And let me just iterate over this, and I will just print out some stuff so you see what's in there. And I have something like a message, so each constraint violation has a message which tells me what has happened here. There's some more stuff. I will just get the property path. So this is essentially the name of the property which has been wired or which carries the invalid constraint. And I also can access a descriptor which describes the constraint. And for instance, I can access the actually annotation and the annotation type. So I will print out this as well. And I will print out just some hash pounds here as a separation. So now if I run this, I should see some nice output on the console. And it's pretty much what I would expect. So I see the error message. It must be a well-formed email address, the property path. It's just email now. And it was about this constraint email. So that's pretty good, pretty nice, pretty simple. Let's enhance this a bit. So I have an order object as well. And so this is represents the order of one hike. And this has a reference to a customer object. And now whenever an order object gets validated, I also want to validate the constraints on the corresponding customer object. So for this, I just put this @valid annotation here. And I go to my test, and I change this now to create an order. And I set the customer of the order to the customer which we have created. And there's also an order number. That's just null. And let me add an @NotNull constraint here to see something more. So I would like to make sure the number of the order isn't null. And now if I validate this order object here, the output should be a bit different. So I'm now getting back a set of constraint violations of order, not of customer. And so I run it again now. And I see now also this constraint on the number property. It may not be null. And the property path for the email constraint, it's now customer.email. So it's just not just the simple property name, but the path from this root object order in this case. So that's how I can add constraints. And I also can add custom constraints. So I would like make sure that certain conditions which are just specific to my use cases or to my requirements are satisfied. And I do this using custom constraint annotations, and I will create one. And it's a bit of typing work, so I will just copy this in, but I will tell you what's going on. So let me add this @valid_order annotation here. I will use it on the order. And the purpose of this one is I would like to make sure that the shipment date of the order is after the order date, right? So it doesn't make sense if the shipment date is before the order date. So this is my requirement here. And in bean validation, what I need to do if I want to implement this kind of constraints which span multiple properties, I need to implement what's called a class-level constraint. So this constraint doesn't sit on any of the properties of this bean, but it sits on the entire class level. And then the constraint validator implementation has access to the entire class. So that's what I'm doing here. So I go to the implementation. Let me check. So this is the definition of this valid order annotation. And using the @target annotation, I say, OK, these are the Java elements where this annotation can be used. It can be used on methods, fields, and so on. It should be accessible at runtime using reflection. That's what I express here. It should be repeatable. I will come to that in a bit. And it's a constraint annotation. So this is the advice to the bean validation engine. This annotation is special. It's a constraint annotation. And it is validated using this validator class. And I have this as an inner class here. It could be an external class, of course. And here I implement this constraint validator interface. And essentially, I just need to implement this isValid method. I get access to the order object. And now here I can make sure the shipment date is after the order date. So that's my implementation. And if I go back to the test now, I just will see whether this works as well. So I create the order date, and it's this local date. Let's say 2017, some date, and the shipment date, it's something in 2016. So it's actually before, so it's not what I want. And now if I run it again, I get this output here as well. So this is the message from this class level constraint. There's no property path because this is just this root object itself. And it's about the valid order constraint. So that's pretty nice. This works. And as I said, I'm usually not in the business of calling bean validation myself. Instead, other components will do this for me, will take care of this for me. And for that, I will now deploy this application. So there's, I have a Wildfly application running on the laptop, which runs the web application we have seen. And this one has a REST endpoint, which takes the order, the requests for persisting order. So that's the endpoint here. So let me deploy this application. And so Wildfly is running. This will just take a few seconds, then the application is redeployed. And I have prepared a JSON request, which I will take a look at here. And this is an order document, and it has embedded the customer object, and the email address of the customer object is not valid, right? So this order request apparently is invalid. So let me get out. And now if I submit this request, so I could do it using the UI, but I will just do it on the command line using this HTTP tool here. So now I will send this document and send it, submit it to this endpoint. And I'm getting back an error, which is nice. But if you look, it tells us it's an internal server error, HTTP 500. So yeah, okay, validation has kicked in, and I see, okay, there was this validation. But if I look at the stack trace a bit closer, I will see, okay, this happened during the validation in JPA, so just at the very last moment in the request lifecycle, and that's not really what I want. Actually, I would like to validate this request when it comes in right at the REST layer. So I would like to have validation happening via JAX-RS. And actually, all I need to do for that is I need to put this addValid annotation here, and now this actually will make the method validation, which I mentioned before, kick in. And now if I deploy again and the request is submitted, then actually validation will be triggered by JAX-RS, and we will see that the output looks just a bit different. So if I now submit the invalid request again, I do get an HTTP 400 error, which is much more what I would like to see here, because it's a bad request, right? Something was wrong with the request. And also JAX-RS gives me this nice representation of the error. So I see now, okay, it's about this constraint sitting on the parameter of the create order method. It's this invalid value and so on. And then, for instance, on a client, I could implement some nice error handling, right? And the last thing I would like to show, so this is still validation happening on the server, but actually it's not limited to this. If I go back to my application and I go here to this hike dialog, so I see here, if I type something, validation is happening right away. And this is, just believe it to me, it's happening on the client side. So this is implemented in AngularJS. And of course, I don't want to duplicate all the constraint information another time in my Angular part of my application, but instead I would like to get all the constraint information from the server somehow and then use it here. And this is what's happening here is I'm using a small project which is called Weldr, V-A-L-D-R. And this one has just one purpose. It provides a servlet as part of my application. And this servlet, it provides a JSON structure with all the constraint information. So let me call just this endpoint here, which is registered by Weldr. That's it. And now I get this JSON representation of all those constraints. So this is about the external hike object, and it has this required constraint, it has this size constraint. And then on the client side, the AngularJS can take over and implement this validation on the client side. And I don't have to duplicate all the constraint metadata again. So that's pretty much what bean validation gives you as of 1.1. And now I would like to tell you a bit what's coming up in bean validation 2.0. So what's the new features there? And for that, I will discuss a number of use cases which I think you will run into regularly in your applications, and then we will see how bean validation 2.0 and Java SE8 will help you with implementing those use cases. And bean validation 2.0, it's a new JSR, so it's a JSR 380. By now, it's still, I think, the newest JSR, so there's no JSR 381. And this is this new version of bean validation. And now you might wonder, why is it 2.0? Why isn't it just 1.2? What justifies this major version jump? And the reason is, when we started to look into this, we found, well, we cannot really implement this new version, which takes advantage of Java 8, and keep backwards compatibility at the same time. So there are many features in Java SE8 which we would like to use, but using those features will make our API not usable on earlier Java versions anymore. So that's why we said, okay, let's make this migration concern. Let's make this very apparent and let's increase the major version number here. And the idea really is to support Java 8 and take advantage of Java 8, and this falls into two categories. So for once, there are many new Java language features which we would like to take advantage of, so we will see this in a bit. So that's the one category of changes. And then the other category is there are API additions in Java SE 8, like the new Java Time API, and of course those API additions should also be supported by bean validation. And with that, let's discuss some of the use cases. So one common use case is you have this constraint which you need to apply multiple times. So for instance, you have a reset password dialog in your application, and now you would like to make sure that depending on the role which the current user has, different requirements should apply regarding the length of the password. So for a regular user, you would like to make sure, okay, the password, it should be like 8 characters long, whereas for administration users or users with the administrator role, the password should be a bit longer. And the way you do this in bean validation is you apply the same constraint multiple times, and then there's this concept of validation groups, and you can assign a constraint to one or more validation groups, which are expressed using class literals. So I say the default should be a minimum size of 8, whereas the administrator users, they should have a longer password, and this constraint is part of the admin group. And until now, you had then to use this list annotation if you wanted to specify this constraint multiple times. So this is the way you do it. Whereas now in Java SE 8 and bean validation 2, you just can specify the constraints several times in a row. So this is one nice thing. It's not a big thing, but I think it's one of those parts of Java SE 8 which makes code just a bit nicer to write and also read. And the interesting thing is, this does not change a bit of the bytecode representation. So under the hood, the compiler will still use this list annotation and create the same bytecode as before. So for code which is using this annotation or which is accessing this annotation, nothing really changes. It's just for you as a reader, as a writer of this code, it gets a bit easier. The next use case is you have this list of names, and now you would like to make sure that no element in this list of names is empty. So there should be no null strings in this list, and there should be no empty strings in this list. And this really has been the most frequent feature request which we have seen in bean validation. So people very often ask, okay, I have this list of strings and I would like to make sure each string is a valid email address. Or I have this list of integers and they should be in a specific interval, whatever. And we looked always for ways how we could express this, and there was not really a good way to do this before Java SE 8. So one could think, let me take a step back. So the not empty annotation on the list element itself, on this names field itself, this will apply to the entire list, right? So this just makes sure that the list itself is not empty. It contains at least one element. This does not say anything about the elements within the list. And now you could think, okay, how could this be done? So one could think, there could be an annotation, let's say, on elements, and it takes the constraint, and now this should be the advice, please advise this constraint, apply this constraint to the elements of this list. But it turns out you cannot implement this kind of annotation on elements in Java, because you cannot have a property constraint which would take any annotation. You just could define constraint in a way so it takes one specific annotation type. So you would need to have one on elements per annotation type, which is very cumbersome, right? So that's not the solution. And it wasn't really doable prior to Java SE 8, whereas now it actually is very nicely doable, because we now have this possibility to put constraints to the type argument of this generic type list of strings. So annotations got much more powerful and much more usable in Java SE 8, because you can put them to many more places, and bean validation takes advantage of this. So now it gets very clear, this addNotEmpty annotation, it does not apply to the list, but it does apply to the string elements which are stored within the list. You could have several constraints there, so you could say, okay, each element should be not empty, and it should satisfy a given regular expression. You could do that. And you could combine it with the not empty on the list itself, right? So now you can say here, okay, the entire list, it should contain at least one element, and each element, it should be not an empty string. And just by having those annotations in the different places, it's very clear what the semantics are. And these improvements to the annotation facility in Java 8, they were specified by JSR 308. And essentially what you have to do is, with for each annotation type, you need to specify where can this annotation be used. And you do this using the @target meta annotation. And there's now a new element type, type use, and you have to use this element type, type use, added to @target, and now your annotation, not empty or size or whatever, can be used on type arguments of generic types. And we also see here this @repeatable annotation. So this is the hint to the compiler to make this a repeatable annotation type and actually use this list annotation type, which is referenced by @repeatable, and create this list annotation in the bytecode. And so we have this possibility to put constraints to type arguments, and not only constraints themselves benefit from that, but also the cascaded validation. So we saw this from the in the order to customer example, but you also can apply cascaded validation to containers and lists and maps and so on. And so far in bean validation one, you put just the @valid annotation to this element itself, and this means make sure when this object defining this addresses property is validated, validate all the addresses in this list. Now I also can put this annotation to the type argument itself. This is, well, you could say just a bit of a cosmetic change, so it doesn't change really very much the semantics. I would say it's a bit nicer because it makes clear, okay, it's about the address, but the behavior will be the same. But the difference gets more apparent if you think about maps. So bean validation always had support for maps and validating maps, but only the values in the map. So you could only apply validation to the values which are stored in the map. Whereas now in bean validation 2, you also can make the keys of a map subject to cascaded validation. And this is done by just putting the @valid annotation to this type argument of the key of a map. I could combine it. So let's say I have this list of maps, this map, and it has as a key address type. So I would like to make sure all the address types which are the keys are valid. And I also would like to make sure that the values are valid. And actually my values here are now lists. So under each key, a list of addresses is stored. And I would like to make sure that all the addresses of all the lists in the map are valid. So I will put the @valid annotation to this type argument of the list type, and then bean validation will take care of this validation. So of course, I should not take it too far. So if I had a very deeply nested generic type, I probably should think about declaring a more tailored, specific, higher level type for this. But bean validation lets you supports validation of cascaded generic types. That's the message here. There are some more container types supported. So Java 8 has this optional type, Java util optional, which you would use as a return value of a method which either might return a value or not, whereas you previously would have returned null. So now the idea is to return this optional, and this makes very clear the return value is optional. And you also can put constraints now to this optional. So this returns a string, and if the string actually is present, it should be a valid email, right? And there's also support for JavaFX, and I have prepared a little project for this. So is anyone using JavaFX, actually? There are 2, 3 JavaFX users. That's great. Those who don't, you might take a look. It's quite a nice API, I would say. And so I have this model here of, it's just a simple bean with name, property, count, property, and so on. And in JavaFX, what you do is you don't use simple types such as int or string as your property types, but you have those string property and list property types and many others. So there's a specific hierarchy of property types which have the advantage of being observable, so that's why they did it. And now bean validation also supports all those JavaFX types. So I can put my @notEmpty constraint here to string property, and then this string represented by the property would be validated. And let me run this example just to show you how it looks like. So this is just a very basic thingy here. And so for instance here, this count property, so it's a property of integer, and it should be at least have a value of at least 50. And this is mapped to this slider bar here. And now it's programmed in the way that there's just this error icon, and if I do this tooltip, I will read it for you, it says must be greater than or equal to 50. And if you take a look at the implementation, it's quite easy, really, as enabled by JavaFX. But the point is, all the JavaFX property types are also supported now for bean validation. So that's very nice. And actually, it doesn't stop there, because we also could think about containers which are provided by specific third-party libraries. So if, for instance, you think about Google Guava, they have a lot of very useful collection types in their API. For instance, there's table and node and like tuples, I think, or tuples. And those are collection types which are independent from the Java collection API largely. There's a multi-map, for instance. It would be very nice if those container element constraints, which we have seen here, if they could be applied to those collection types from the Guava API. Or there are other JVM languages like Ceylon or Scala, which actually have their own collection APIs altogether, which are completely independent of the Java collection API. And of course, also, I would like to apply constraints to the elements of those collection types. So it would be very nice if this was possible. And actually, it is possible because we have defined an extractor API. So it's an extension point to the API. And this allows you to plug in value extractors. And those value extractors, they will provide the values from those containers to the validation engine so that those values then can be validated. And as an example, I have here this table type from Google Guava. And a table, you could imagine this like an Excel spreadsheet. So it's made of rows and columns, and then there's a value associated to each cell. And here I have this table, which is revenue per year and category. So the rows are the years, and the columns are the categories. And then in each cell, I have a value. And now I would like to make sure that the value in this table, all the values are a positive number, right? So you don't want to have a negative revenue. And I will show you how we can do this. So bean validation itself, of course, it does not know of Google Guava, right? And we cannot add support to the spec for Google Guava because it's just, well, in library, and we can't have support for that in the specification. But I will show you how easy it actually is to add support for this. Just checking the time. That's all right. So I have this custom extractor test somehow there, here. And make it a bit larger. So I have here this class revenue data, which just has this property we have just seen, revenue per year and category. I have here this constraint at positive, which, by the way, is a new constraint as of bean validation 2.0. And I have a simple test, which just takes a revenue data object and validates it and just emits the property path. And in this example data here, I'm inserting one negative value, which should cause the validation to fail, right? So let me run this. And let's see what happens. And it gives me an error. In the error message, it says, well, I detected this at positive constraint on this type argument, but I don't know how to get the values because I don't know about Guava's table. So I don't have any value extractor for this. So we need to add this value extractor. I will create it. And let me say it's the table cell extractor. And this implements the value extractor interface. And this is parameterized with the type to extract from, so that's table. And it has just one method. And this one method I need to implement. And what it does is it takes as an input the original value, the table to extract the values from, and it takes a callback object, a receiver object, which I need to call for all the values which I extract from this table. So this is very neat to emit my values to. There's one more thing I need to do. So table has three type parameters, and I need to tell which of the type parameters is this extractor about. So is it about rows or keys or values? This is about values. So I put the add extracted value annotation to this type argument here, because that's the we type argument. And now I just implement this method. And table, it has a method cell set, so I can iterate over this. Let me see what happens. So it's not an int, but it's a table. Oops, what then? It's a table cell. And from cell, I can get a value, the row key and the column key, and what else I need. So I go to my receiver object. And this has now different methods, which I need to call if I want to emit this value. And I will call keyed value because, well, this table structure, it has a key for each value, which is comprising the row and the column key. So I call keyed value, and I need to emit a node name. We will see in a minute where this is used. So let me say cell value. And then I need to provide the key object, and I have created a class for this, which is called cell key. I will show you it in a bit. But it just is for creating a two-string representation, actually. So this creates this cell key, and I need to get the value, cell get value. So let me take a look at the cell key class. It just has the row key and the column key, and it creates a two-string representation. So that's all it's doing. So I iterate over the set of table cells, and for each cell, I call this keyed value method and emit the value for this specific key. And there's one more thing I need to do. I need to take the name of this implementation, and I put it into this file, which is the basis for the Java service loader. So if I have this file under meta-inf services and then the fully qualified name of this interface, then the implementation, the validation implementation will look up all the implementation names which are given within this file. So I just have one implementation name, table cell extractor, but this is enough to make this implementation known to the validation engine. So, and now if I run this one again, I should not get the error anymore, but instead I see this property path which I have printed out, and it says, okay, it's about the revenue per year and category property, and then it's a keyed object, so that's represented by the braces, then the cell key which I'm using, and then the cell value. So the last part is this node name which I emitted. So this is just this two-string representation. The property path actually is an object, so I could examine this property path and its nodes and create a more business-friendly error representation, for instance. And with that, I could support now all kinds of different containers, essentially. All right, so that's it in terms of cell. Or container validation. Then another use case, which very frequently is used, is the validation of times. And if you think about our application, we would like to make sure that the delivery date of a hike order is in the future. And bean validation always had these constraints at past and at future, which you could use for calendar and date. And now, as I mentioned, Java SE8 has this new API for date and time with all those nice types such as local date time, year months, zone date time, and so on. And all those new temporal data types, they are supported by bean validation. So you just could put the at future annotation now to this local date property, and this will work. And there are some types in this date and time API which actually don't represent one specific instant on the timeline, but more like an interval. So this local date, it represents essentially an entire day. Or we have a type year month, which represent a year and a month, and there's year, which represents a year. And now there's this new property, all present, which lets you say, okay, this constraint or this property, it should be either in the future or it should be now. So if I had this at future constraint on a year, the entire current year would be valid. It might be a day in the past, as long as it's in this year. So this is what gets enabled by this. And another tricky point, if you related to date and time, is if you think about testing. So for instance, you write the test for making sure that the delivery date is in the future. So now you might set this date in your test to a point very far in the future, and your test will be green for many years, but then let's say you have set it to some day in 2020, and that's fine for the coming 4 years, but then 2020 has actually arrived, and your test starts to fail out of a sudden, and this is because now your test date is not in the future any longer. And this is because so far bean validation always used the current time of the JVM as the reference point for what is now and what is in the future or what is in the past. And this is not always what you want. Or if you think about a multi-user application, you might not want to take the time and time zone from the server as now, but you might actually want to take a time zone information from the currently logged in user. And all this gets more flexible now by this notion of a clock provider. And when you bootstrap a validator or validator factory, you could plug in now your custom clock provider, and it returns a clock. And a clock is essentially just a time and a time zone, which then will be used by beam validation. And here in this example, I'm having this fixed clock provider, so it will always return the same time and time zone, which is useful for testing. If you think about this multi-user application, it might be a clock provider which gets the time zone from the currently logged in user. And this is also integrated with CDI, for instance. So I could, for instance, get this time zone information from some kind of request context if I wanted to. Yeah, just quickly some other improvements. So when I implement a constraint validator, I need to implement this interface constraint validator, and it has two methods really. So it has an initialize method which takes the constraint, and I can then access the constraint and access all the attributes and store it in my class. And then in the isValid method, I can actually validate values and access those constraint properties. But then if you have a constraint which does not have any properties, this initialize method just is empty. So in this case, not null. There are no properties defined on the addNotNull constraints, so this initialize method is just some overhead. And now in Java 8, I just can omit this. And this is possible because we made this a default method. So in Java SE 8, you can have default methods and interfaces. And we made this an empty default method, meaning you just don't need to provide this method if you don't actually need to access the state of annotations. So it's a small improvement, but again, it's helping with reducing verbosity and making this stuff a bit nicer. We added some new constraints, and we were very eager to get community feedback on this. So we did actually two polls on our blog and then on Twitter where we asked people, okay, what kinds of constraints are you actually using which are not yet part of the spec, and which would you like to see in the spec? And what we also did is we went to GitHub, and some member from the expert group wrote a script which crawled through all the Java repositories on GitHub and was looking for all those usages of constraints which are not defined by the bean validation API. So this might be either constraints provided by the reference implementation or even custom constraints from specific projects. And so we came up with a list of constraints which are very commonly used apparently on projects on GitHub. Then we made this poll, and we ended up with those constraints which will be added to the spec. So there's now not empty, not blank for strings. There's @email, which has been part of Hibernate Validator and which is now part of the spec. And there is these constraints for making sure numbers are negative or positive. And this was very nice to have this kind of community feedback and see what people really need. And in terms of a status, so where are we with this JSR? And each JSR goes through a specific life cycle. And one very important point is this public review, which essentially is a voting by the executive committee. And you do this if the JSR has advanced quite a lot. So you're pretty much sure, okay, this should be our API. This is what we would think should be in the spec. And now we really would like to gather the community at large and have some more feedback on this. So before that, you could do a number of early drafts, which are quite informal. Now with the public draft, it's much more formal because the executive committee of the JCP, of the Java community process, votes on this. And this has just passed last week. Luckily, I'm very happy to say that almost all of the members voted. I think some probably just did not vote. Maybe they forgot, I don't know. But that's pretty good indication because we now know, okay, this JSR apparently it's perceived well and we can move forward with finalizing it. And so that's the life cycle of the JSR. Probably cannot read it too well, but the next step after the public review and the ballot on the public review is the proposed final draft, which is essentially where you say, okay, I'm 99% sure this is what should be in there, and you get some more feedback on this. And then after that, there's the final approval ballot. And the final approval ballot is another voting by the executive committee, and if this passes, then the JSR essentially is a done deal. And this proposed final draft will likely be out this week, so I need to polish some more stuff and then it will be ready to be submitted. And the good thing is all of this is implemented already in the reference implementation, so each JSR has its reference implementation, and in our case it's Hibernate Validator. And all this stuff is there, so the latest release is beta 2. Once the proposed final draft is out. There will be a CR1 of 512.8.6, and this allows you to try out all those features, and you can, well, play with the container constraints, use the new constraints, and everything which you have seen. And I would ask you to take a look, run this in the applications. If you are building applications on Wildfly, we also provide a patch file which allows you to update your Hibernate Validator version and your Bean Validation API version in Wildfly to the latest one. Is anyone using Wildfly and running on Wildfly? Okay, that's good. You could also run on JBoss EAP, by the way. But we have this patch file. You just pull this into your installation, and then you will have Bean Validation 2.0 and could test all those features you have seen. And then the idea is it should be part of Java EE8. As you might know, the schedule is very close to its final date, so at the end of July. Or David might know more, I don't know. It should be finalized. And Java Bean Validation should be part of this. Yeah, just very quickly, we had some more features planned for Bean Validation 2.0. We did not come to this. One thing I would like to mention is this constraint API. So currently you have annotations to apply constraints, and you have XML, if this is your kind of thing. To put constraints, and there should be a third way, which is an API, and this makes it more dynamic how you create constraints. So you could apply constraints depending on different use cases, different states in the application. And this is an API which we currently have in the reference implementation. So you navigate to a type, you navigate to a property, and then you apply some constraints. So this is something which might be part of Bean Validation 2.1. Also the support of the same API, but it uses now Lambda expressions. So here in this case, I just have this file exists constraint, and I don't even have a validator. I just say, please, when this constraint is applied to the type file, then please invoke this Lambda expression. So this might also something we add. And for sure, we will improve support for Java 9. So Java 9 has not been finalized yet, so we cannot really do very much about it in the spec. But in Bean Validation 2.1, we will for sure have support for Java SE 9. Yeah, with that, I'm almost done. Some resources. So beanvalidation.org is the central hub for everything on Bean Validation. That's the URL you really should remember. Then the one very close to my heart is latest draft diff2.1.1, because this is a rendered diff document which has all the changes compared to the previous version. So this will make it very easy for you to review all those changes. And I would ask you, take a look and let us know about your feedback. Everything is open source on GitHub, the API, the reference implementation, the documentation. The TCK, the test kit, is also open source. So this means each implementation which needs or which wants to be a certified implementation, it has to pass this test suite, this TCK. And it's a very good thing that this is open source, because this makes it very easy to understand the test cases, challenge them, and so on. And again, if you would like to know any updates about Bean Validation or any other stuff, just follow me on Twitter. And with that, I am done. I think there are 2 more minutes or 1.5 minutes for questions. Thank you so far. Yeah. Okay, the question is it part of EE and SE? So no, it is part of the Java EE platform 8, but then you can use it on Java SE as well, but it is not a part of Java SE. Yeah. Other questions? If not, you also can just come to me afterwards on the hallway if you like. All right, thank you. And I got some stickers. So you will get one. And yeah.